little clown of Bethlehem. This is Wretched Radio, sent to idea@wretched.org. A commercial for a church in Australia for Christmas. They wrote a musical. Everybody was dressed up with paint on their face, big floppy shoes, probably horns. And it was titled, O Little Clown of Bethlehem, so that people could, you know, relate more to the holiday of the birth of the Savior. Another tragic effort. I learned something actually about Christmas and plays and demonstrations. If this is accurate, because, you know, history is a little tough to trace, St. Francis of Assisi is the fellow who created the creche, the manger scene. And he did so to teach people, to show them what the nativity was like. So the concept, the idea of using props and gizmos, if we're going to blame anybody, why not St. Francis of Assisi?
Preach the gospel always, and when necessary, use a nativity scene.
Was watching Rick Steves do his Christmas special. Really quite well done. It's really just beautiful over in Europe. And I believe it was on that program, they were showing the different manger scenes from around the globe. So they would have, in Italy, they did Italian. It looked like it was, the birth happened in a Tuscan village or villa. And they had some for Alaskans, for Eskimos. And it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. Rather than changing the story, transporting it into a different zip code, how's about just, I don't know, teaching the story and preaching it? We don't need gimmickry. We need the Word of God. Gimmicks do not convert. The Word of God teaches. And speaking of teaching the Word of God, I went to, wow, a really disappointing Christmas Eve service. Didn't go to our regular church. Decided to do something different this year because of family and schedules and all of that. I'm going to leave the name of the church out of it because they're not heretics. They just never, you know, preached the gospel. The youth pastor brought the kids up and talked to the kids about the light that has come into the world. And now the light, you know, when it's really dark and somebody lights a candle, you know, it's still pretty dark, but then it gets lighter and lighter and lighter, which it actually doesn't. It's just your eyes adjusting better and better and better. Nevertheless, it gets brighter. That's because the light shines in darkness. And that's why you need to be a light. That's why you need to be at your school and in your home. You need to be a light. All right, kids, you're dismissed.
Hold it.
Hold on. Mm-hmm. Hold on.
Yeah.
Anything in there about our sin, the wrath of God, Jesus Christ shining the light into darkness because he is the truth, coming to this earth to save sinners, and our rightful response is to fall to our knees and worship him, and then shine a light in darkness because the light has shined on us. That was not the gospel. That was simply law. That's all it was. And it was delivered all sweet and all nice and all friendly on a kid's level, but it wasn't the gospel. So the senior pastor gives it a go. He gets up to tell his story about Jesus being a great gift and that, wow, there's never been a gift like this. And I was once given a gift. It was a diaper because my daughter was trying to tell me that they're pregnant. And then he flashed a picture of him and his granddaughter up on these two huge screens of him and his granddaughter. Who was the centerpiece for that sermon illustration? It wasn't Jesus. And he never explained why we needed this gift. He never explained the point of it. He just missed Christmas entirely. He missed the gospel. It didn't even come close to the gospel. Now, he didn't say anything wrong per se, but when we don't teach everything about the gospel, then it's no gospel at all. And all we do is confuse people. No wonder why 70% of our kids are leaving churches like that. Within the first year at university, they're saying, bye-bye Christianity. We need to be surgeons when it comes to presenting the gospel, rightly cutting, rightly dividing, making sure that we aren't missing any details. I got to tell you, I left there really disappointed that on Christmas Eve, a church, pretty big one too, doesn't even appear to know the gospel. My mood, it didn't improve much on New Year's Eve. Every single year this happens. Every single year. We don't do anything really for New Year's Eve. We just, you know, I think we're just reading. I think Mrs. Friel was putting together a puzzle. Yep, we are that fascinating. We just sit around and read or write or play, do puzzles, whatever. And just, you know, oh, what is that word? Communicate with one another. We don't use our thumbs. We actually talk to one another. And so we turned on the TV. I think a football game was on for a short amount of time. And then began the New Year's Eve celebrations. Oh, if they're a representation of our country, we are in big trouble. I thought it was fascinating when in Times Square we had two contestants seeing who could put the most marshmallows into their mouth. Hey, that's fascinating for network TV.
Hey, that's a long-hallowed youth group tradition.
Exactly. But they should have incorporated some peanut butter. They would have had themselves a ratings bonanza. Another network. The woman, she didn't know who she was going to kiss, so she picked out three guys from the crowd that she was interested in. And then to determine which fellow, she had a cardboard cutout of herself, and they were to practice kissing, demonstrating how well they kissed so that she could pick the kisser that she wanted to kiss when the thing dropped from the sky. That is the bet. That's America? Christina Aguilera in some bawdy performance? That's our country? And so as we begin a new year, whether you are, by the way, Anderson Cooper also got drunk on TV. So that was really kind of a highlight, right? There was some rapper fellow couldn't understand a single word that he was saying. Nevertheless, it is that time of year when a lot of people, they tend to make resolutions, whether you do or not, totally up to you. It's just be careful that you don't make an oath that you can't keep. Resolve, I'm going to give this a go. But if you make a promise, you better keep it. But you may want to take this particular article, Rethinking the Rat Race from the Cripplegate, to just take a look as we begin the new year about how much you are working. Christians are to be the best workers there are. We should be the hardest workers. We are not lazy people. God is not slothful. God wants us to work hard because he works hard and it reflects him. Nevertheless, there is a line where a man or woman can cross it. How do you know where that line is? Well, let's ask the question, what is too much work? I think that if because of work, your family is not happy, disintegrating, at odds with one another, that could be a sign. Your health is going down the ringer. How's about your ability to find that time to read your Bible and pray to God? How's about it impinges, that's right, I just said impinges, on attending church or serving at church? That would suggest your schedule is unbalanced. So here are five possible reasons you're overworking. One, it's necessity. You got to do it. There is nothing wrong with that. There are seasons when we just have got to get busy, and we have got to work a lot. Number two reason some people work a lot, exploitation. Some corporate, environments, they demand it. Their performance reviews, was it Apple or Microsoft, one of those where it was, Google, one of those where it was revealed, you better work, like, a lot. Or you ain't going nowhere except to the breadline. That sometimes that happens. Oh, it's Amazon. Look at that right here in the article. New York Times wrote on the work culture of Amazon was more frightening than any National Geographic special on the violence in the Amazon jungle. You've got to give 80 hours a week. Otherwise, you're weak. Workers chided for not replying to emails immediately, even received at midnight. At home. Maybe that's why you're working too much. What should you do? You've got to ask yourself those aforementioned questions. Am I neglecting my family? Am I neglecting my soul? Am I neglecting my service to the body? And then work to wisely make adjustments. Number three reason, dedication. You're just dedicated to it more than necessary, done to pursue a particular personal objective like more money, a promotion, or maybe retirement. Four, this is where it gets personal, avoidance. You'd rather be at work than at home. Examine that. Another reason could be disorganization. Spend so much time being just doing fits and starts all over the place that you're not very productive, and therefore you have to work longer hours to compensate for all those things that you've been busy not getting done. Whatever it happens to be, I can't write the rule. I can't tell you how many hours, but use those examination questions to determine, is it possible that my priorities and my affections are out of whack? Because there is a priority of things, and work is not at the top of the list. This is Wretched Radio.